I'll call to order the March 2016 meeting of the Finance Committee. We are starting a half hour earlier than normal. We do have a very heavy schedule, but we will do our best to get through it. We will start with the consent agenda. Are there any items anyone would want pulled from consent? Ms. Burke?
Yes, C1A.
1A, C1A.
And C4.
And 4. Ms. Adams, I'll let you look a minute. Yes, sir, Mr. Montgomery.
C3, C7.
3 and 7, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Taylor?
No.
McIntosh, Nick Bessie?
I move for approval.
Wait a minute. I've got 5, 8, and 16. Now, can I have a motion to approve the balance?
Move for approval of the balance of the consent agenda.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve the balance of the consent. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is approved. We will go to the first item the Secretary will read, C1A.
Item C1A, resolution authorizing the sale of a certain city-owned vacant lot on East 23rd Street under the upset bid procedure. North Carolina General Statutes 168 269, located in the Northeast Ward, for $1,500.
All right. Ms. Burke?
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee and other people, I do not have a problem. This is something I want to bring to the attention, because we have in some of the older neighborhoods, we have houses where people are purchasing their homes, and then you have these vacant lots. So just explain briefly what we're doing.
We've received a request to purchase a lot. A vacant city lot that we've had in inventory for a number of years, and the family homeowners own the house next door, and they have approached the city about buying this vacant lot, which would be in addition to their yard, and that they would upkeep it and take it off the city rolls for upkeep and put it back on the tax rolls.
Yes.
Thank you.
And some of them are citizens who are moving to the country for the first time, mm-hmm. and they're taking pride in their neighborhood. So, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I move for approval.
We have a motion to second on C1A. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise, that is approved. The next one I have is C3.
Item C3, update on the contract renewal process for the downtown Winston-Salem Business Improvement District.
Guy who wanted it. Mr. Montgomery wanted that one. Go right ahead, sir. Could you give us a brief explanation of what this item is, please?
Yes. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
During last year's session of the General Assembly, there were some modifications made to the legislation and statutes for the municipal service districts. One of those involves when you enter into or renew a contract with a nonprofit agency, similar to how our setup is with the downtown Winston-Salem partnership. One of those requirements is to have a public input session of the residents and property owners within the district. So that is scheduled for this Wednesday at the Benton Convention Center.
Okay. That's all. Thank you very much. And I think this is just for information only.
Mm-hmm.
And this is published, folks can read about it. Okay, next is C4.
Item C4, consideration of items relating to Urban Development Action Grant Funds and a forgivable loan to Southeast Plaza Investors, LLC.
Who asked for this?
I did.
Ms. Burke, go right ahead.
Yes, who's going to be explaining this one? Who's going to be speaking?
I think.
All right. I just need to know what's the difference from the original, if there's any difference to be explained, so the records will have it.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, Chairman Clark, members of the committee. There is a slight difference. Essentially, what this action does is substitute the funding that was originally put into the additional assistance that the Southeast Plaza property received in February of last year. As part of the additional assistance that council approved, approximately $250,000 of that was from UDAG funds, which is a federal fund source. That triggered compliance with a federal act known as Davis-Bacon. That was not discovered until recently. So that triggering of the federal compliance created some compliance issues on the part of Southeast Plaza Investors. And so we're essentially switching the fund source from the UDAG money that was originally provided as part of the additional assistance in 2015 to the sources that you see listed there, RUCA infrastructure funds and economic development project funds, totaling $250.
Thank you. Any questions, comments?
Question.
Ms. Adams?
So, in reality, Mr. Evans, what are you telling us? I'm just being real. Compliance, you know, are we talking about there was a transaction made or an agreement made that we later found out that we should not have done based on federal government, no. XYZ?
I wouldn't characterize it that way.
Okay.
I think it was a miss on our part, staff part, to notify the Southeast Plaza investors that the compliance with Davis-Bacon had been triggered by the inclusion of federal funds in that second round of assistance that they received. So once it was discovered that that was the case, we went back. Once it came to our attention that, yes, in fact, the infusion of those federal funds had triggered the need to comply with Davis-Bacon, that's the point at which we went back to Southeast Plaza investors, notified them of that. Of course, this was a couple of years after that funding had been inserted into the project. They said, we're fine complying. However, we just simply do not have the information necessary at this point to comply with Davis-Bacon.
So it was our fault because we missed it. Is this our fault really, right?
Yeah.
Councilman Adams, can I add something? Additional information here. The UDAG money came from 1980. HUD has told us in every other opinion up till most recently that because that money has been washed and gone through more than 30 years of laundering or cleanup.
That's a bad word.
But it's been recycled through the system multiple times.
It's been gone
times.
For projects paid
yeah.
back.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Because it's been recycled through the system so many different times that it did not have to be treated as federal money. So we weren't following federal guidelines, which in essence are the Davis-Bacon guidelines most recently. The most recent interpretation or decision that we've gotten from HUD is you should still be treating that money as CDBG or federal type money. So even though it's been recycled through the system, still follow federal guidelines. That's what has created the issue.
And I don't have a problem with it. Again, I guess it goes back to us. You know what I'm saying? That we found it or whatever. And I guess I'm looking for when you present us information like this, I'm always looking for, okay, there was an issue, we found it, what's the corrective action to ensure not just with Davis-Bacon, but any other, federal or legal compliance issues we may have in the future. This comes back to what I was always saying, 6 going on 7 years. Somebody needs to be looking at our policies and procedures a little bit more closer than what we do when we go through these transactions to ensure that they're compliant with every letter of the law and the ordinance and policies of Winston-Salem. That's all I'm saying. This is one of these things here that, yeah, we did the corrective action. We didn't list it. But to someone reading this and the way it was just explained by both of you, it could cause some other questions because now I'm seeing some other hands go up from some other councilmen.
Our attorney would like to comment if I could ever interject.
And I just want to make a clarification. Because Davis-Bacon was actually in the documents that he signed. I think the misstep was in terms of staff sitting down with him and requesting the paperwork in a timely manner, so it was not requested until several years later. But Davis-Bacon was actually in the documents that he signed. So it was there for him to know he had to comply, but I think there was a misstep, because normally when Davis-Bacon is triggered, someone sits down, staff sits down with him and explains, you know, what is needed and so forth. So I think there was a misstep on that meeting.
So, Attorney Carmen, going forward, how do we ensure that doesn't happen again?
Just once the documents are executed, then it's incumbent upon staff to set the time frame within which to get with the borrower so they'll know what they need to do to comply. Because seeing it on paper, you may not necessarily understand what that entails. But staff will sit down with the person and go over what's necessary.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Evans.
Yes, I'd like to add that since this particular time, staff has, in fact, put in some additional safeguards surrounding compliance with not only Davis-Bacon, but some other federal guidelines. So whenever Davis-Bacon language or anything requiring and necessitating federal compliance, we have some hard and fast measures and safeguards that we put in place to ensure that this sort of communication is not missed in the future.
Okay. We had another hands up. I'll call on Ms. Light.
Tell me if I'm wrong about this, Evan. In effect, pointing out to the borrowers that they had to comply with Davis-Bacon would require them to pay a going wage?
That's correct.
That's really what Davis-Bacon is.
In effect, what we're doing is allowing them to keep out on their workers?
Well, what?
I
wouldn't characterize it that way. I'd say that we have, we just simply don't have the documentation. What we can't do is confirm that the workers for that period of time between about 2013 to now were paid the prevailing wages, the wages specified within the Davis-Bacon Act. Yes.
And some of the contractors are out of business, from what I understand.
Okay.
Mr. Best, did you have your hand up?
Basically, that was the point I was going to make earlier, that it looks like the difficulty here would be reconstructing the documentation of the wage rates that were paid by subcontractors that are no longer in business.
Right.
Okay. All right. Anyone else? Any other?
Yes.
Ms. Burke.
Since I did ask for this to be brought out, and I do still have some concerns, this is not the first time when information that has been presented to this council that I have emphasized, even before Councilwoman started speaking about it clearly, that we need to stop bringing information before this council, before the public, and we don't do a thorough job in making the presentation as it should be made. I have said if this was a big business, which we are, it would not be allowed. And I am tired of hearing excuses more than one time about projects that come before us, and you make these excuses. These are taxpayers' dollars, and we should respect those dollars. Also, the question I wanted to ask concerning this project, so that the public will understand, this project will or will not have any effect on the RUCA money and what for other areas in this community.
That's
changing anyway.
That's correct.
Say it so we can have it for the record.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. The question was about the effect of this project on other RUCA projects. This, what we're discussing here today, has no impact on funding either proposed or already allocated for other RUCA projects.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Montgomery.
Yes. Just one. My question, original question, was the same one that Councilman Bessie was going to state out in reference to the difficulty of going back in the past. But moreover, one of the things I think we really need to take into account is not just the city in being responsible in what we do for ensuring that we follow the federal guidelines, but the penalty on not following that is that individual group who received these funds would have to pay back those dollars, and as well as the city having to pay back those dollars if Davis-Bacon isn't followed. Right. And if we think about some of these who've received some of these funds, it would be almost detrimental to some of those groups. And so that's why it's even more important to make sure that this happens, because we're in a good position where we can substitute some funds. But if that was not the case, then it could have been detrimental both to us as a city, but then more so even though that individual organization that was in receipt of those funds. And that's one place of higher concern.
If I could ask staff to add to what we have here today for the general meeting next week. One, a definition of what Davis-Bacon is. It's a term we're throwing around, but it is a federal law setting wage rates. Secondly, if you got any information on what the local prevailing rates are in certain categories, would be helpful just for FYI. And thirdly, it would be helpful to know what other projects are underway right now or soon to be underway that this would apply to, if it applies to all the other RUCA projects and this, that, and the other. and some assurance that those folks have been properly notified. Because as Mr. Montgomery said, this is just a paperwork change for us. But if we didn't have another pot of money, we would be in trouble.
Yeah.
Okay? How's that sound to everybody?
Sounds good.
Do I have a motion to move this forward?
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion to second. All in favor? Go ahead.
I just wanted to go back and re-ask the question that Mayor Pro Tem Burke did. We're moving pot money around between different pots, so essentially there's no impact going forward. We can use that UDAG money just like we would RUCA money.
That's correct. Yeah, that's correct.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I'm abstaining.
And one abstention. So we have three in favor, none opposed, one abstaining on item C4. We will now go to item C5.
Item C5, resolution authorizing the city manager to enter into an agreement with Novant Health for employee medical services in the amount of $142,900.
Ms. Cruz, I believe I asked for this one to be pulled. What we have right now is we have some Novant employees that administer kind of basic medical services to employees if I didn't feel well or cut my finger or had the flu or whatever. And we currently offer it two days a week. And that's Tuesdays and Thursdays?
Uh-huh.
And then we're looking to go to two more days. Which days are those?
We're not sure yet. We're looking to increase it by 8 hours. We think that's probably going to end up being four days, 4 hours a day, but we're not quite sure about that yet.
My only comment that I have here, and I think it's a good program because it allows us to respond quickly to employees, but also keeps them out of the emergency room, which can be very expensive mm-hmm. for folks. Is 16 hours a week enough, is my question to you.
It might not be, but what we'd like to do is to move to 16 hours a week and see how that works, and if we need additional hours to then expand beyond that.
Okay. But I certainly think if you look at what we have saved, because we do provide health insurance, and we're the ones that, and it's self-funded, so we, after the deductible, we would be picking up the cost of a mini clinic or a emergency room, or if someone was out for a longer period of time, we have to pick that up as well.
Correct.
So anyway, I think it's a good idea. Do I have a motion to move forward? Yes, ma'am. More questions?
Yes. And this is located where, in City Hall?
No, it's where? On 32nd Street.
On 32nd Street, because it doesn't, unless I missed it.
It doesn't say in there it that it's on 32nd Street.
No, seriously. Yeah. I was, by reading this, I was thinking you're talking about down here in the main building, and that was what my question was going to be about.
But, is that our employee medical services office on 32nd?
But, again, with the way healthcare is and everything, and I guess it's just a follow-up to go look into, what are other cities doing that's similar to this? Are our other cities in North Carolina, comparable to our size? Are they doing this as well? And I guess my question mark is, if this was all that, other companies would be doing it, but I don't see a lot of companies having on private industry, maybe cities, I don't see them having on staff where people can go and we start adding these hours and adding people that come to do this. So I need to see, for me, more information as to other cities that are doing this and how successful this is, maybe if they're willing to disclose their savings or whatever. But I don't know.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, just a comment. I know a lot of large private employers do offer an on-site RN or something for this very reason.
They do, and there are a few municipalities that offer it as well.
Yeah.
And I can get you a list of those.
Okay, well, that would be very helpful. Ms. Burke?
Yes, this has something that's positive because, say, for instance, flu shots. Instead of people going, they can get them right here on site. It does save money. And a lot of times with certain things happening, people run to the emergency rooms, and we know that's just too much. So I think as something we're doing, we can just check it a little bit more.
Okay. All right.
Move.
Okay, we have a motion and a second, don't we?
I have
go ahead.
Comment. For the record, I'm not against it. I'm a person that everybody knows. I'm about safety. I'm about health care. I'm about all of that. But what I'm saying is when we began to start adding on features when we've already just come through some other contract negotiations with some of the health care providers and other things that we're doing, I just like to see where that falls. in our lineup of services, not to to employees, but where it falls to our bottom line as well. I mean, I know we have it here, but I need to see it side to side besides everything else that we're doing so we can have a clear understanding. Again, anything that promotes the health care and the safety of our employees, I'm a cheerleader for that. But again, it goes back to me. I just need to see more information when we're making these kinds of decisions. That's all.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion and a second. We'll go get some additional information. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, likewise. C5 is approved. The next one I have is C7.
Item C7, resolution rejecting all bids for Winston Lake Park development located in the East Ward.
Mr. Montgomery asked for this one. Mr. Bates, come on up. Why don't you give us a brief update, and then we'll have Mr. Montgomery ask his question. Everybody knows what we're talking about.
My update on this project, it is, has sat in limbo for quite some time now, waiting for a recommendation. And so at this point in time, the bids for this project were received back in December 11th. Terms of the bidding documents generally allow bids to stay open for 60 days. So during the evaluation of the project, we had two incidences. The parent low bidder failed to submit sufficient good faith efforts. That was determined by both the internal committee and the Citizens Advisory Board. In addition, the bids now have exceeded those 60-day time frames. So our recommendation to you all is to reject all bids based on both of those conditions.
Okay, Mr. Montgomery.
Well, there was a comment on the fact of this, and that was in the fact that we want the public to understand and know, we want the media to write very clearly that if contractors do not perform good faith efforts on submitting their documents to the city, that we will reject the bids. I was very clear in the community meeting I had with citizens in this area that the recommendation that will come forward will be that we will reject the bids on this project because the contractor that was receiving the lowest bid had not done a good faith effort in terms of making sure that they were able to meet the participation requirements within the document. And it is very essential to make sure that when individuals come to us with this, that they understand that that is a serious factor that's taken highly in consideration. My individual community understand that we'll put these back out to bid again, and again looking for community, those who submit, to understand that they have to meet that standard.
Mr. Bates, the bids were over budget anyway, and I know there's some other paperwork in here today we're going to look at on funding some of that, but do you have this thing, you think, properly valued engineered so that when you go back out, we will get acceptable bids?
I'm not personally involved in the value engineering.
Yeah, you just the purchasing. Here's the engineer. Okay. Mr. Prescott.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. We are currently working with the architect, using a lot of what we learned from this first bid to remove some items, and we will have a package ready to go out to bid the 1st of April that we feel will come in under budget.
Thank you very much. So you'll be going out to bid in April?
That's correct.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Do we have a motion to approve this?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, likewise. That is approved. We'll now go to C8.
Item C8, resolution authorizing the purchase of software maintenance from Mitchell Humphrey and Company in the amount of $134,030.
Afternoon, Chairman, council members.
I think I pulled this one, and my one question was, and I know we have software contracts, so don't have an issue there, but it did call for a yearly increase not to exceed 10%, and I think in today's environment, a 10% annual increase is too high.
Okay. Can I speak to that?
Yes, you may.
I do have the last several years of their increase from the same vendor. This year, they're asking for a 3.1 from last year. 2015 was 3.9. 2014, 3.9. 2013, 3.6. 2012, 6.4. 2011, they actually gave us a 10% decrease because we asked all vendors because of the economic condition. 2010 was a 9.7. That was probably the largest. Yeah. And other than that, it was in the 3 to 4% other than one other year back to.
Now, it says 10% annual increase. Do you mean 10% over 3 years or 10% per year?
We have it so it won't be no more than 10% per year.
per year.
And we did that based on what the worst case was in the last 10 years. But okay. What I'm making is they have not gone more than 4% in the last 4 or 5 years.
Okay. It would be helpful for me if we would go back to them and see if they would accept a smaller. I will not support this at 10%.
I believe if I asked them to put it at 5%, they would agree to that. But I could look into it.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Garrity, do you have a comment?
I don't believe Tom's actually negotiated the increases for this. The following years have yet. What he put in here was trying to give us authority of up to 10%.
Right, not to exceed 10%.
So if you wanted to give us authority up to 4%, that'd be fine. If no more than 4, we'd have to come back to you anyway.
Yeah, so. Okay. So it's okay with you folks. I would like to amend this to 4%. Is this?
Second.
Mr. Attorney, Mrs. Attorney, can I do that?
Yes.
All right.
And
sure I don't get in trouble.
I will circle back with the vendor before next Monday.
Okay. But what it would be if for some reason they were more than 4%, you'd have to come back to the committee. Right.
Yes. That's okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
So I've changed that to 4%. Any other questions, comments? If not, I look for a motion.
I move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on C8. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is approved. The last item on consent is C16.
Item C16, resolution of support with financial commitment and authorization to apply for the 2016 Transportation Invest Generating Economic Recovery Grant.
Mr. Turner, I had this one pulled. I've got a question, but why don't you tell everybody kind of what's going on here?
Mr. Chairman, that term that you use stands for, is an acronym, TIGER, and the TIGER grants are a federal grant that comes open every so often. We have an opportunity to apply for it. Oftentimes, federal transportation grants are an 80-10 or 80-20 match. Excuse me. This has an unusual characteristic. It's a much larger grant than a lot of them, but it does have a 50% match. We feel that the pedestrian side path project along Business 40 is our best opportunity to be successful in applying for these grants. One of the things about it, however, is that although we're asking for authority to apply now and asking for a resolution indicating that, we wouldn't be obligated to provide our 50% match until several years into the future, which means that we have opportunities for using future bond revenues or other sources that would come available to us as much as 4 or 5 years from now. So it's not as though an obligation right now means that we have to expend this money. Even if we got the grant approved, it would be expended at such time as we needed for the project.
Thank you, sir. Any questions? Mr. Montgomery, you've got your hand up.
There's a question. I know at one point in time we were examining the possibility of submitting a request for funds under Tiger Grant for Union Station project and additional funds there. And if I'm not mistaken, it's because of the nature and dollar amount of the project is why we weren't in line for this, just to...
After we did look closely at both of those projects, and this one was felt to be the better opportunity to be successful in our grant application when we consulted with our federal lobbyist.
And was large part the financial, the cost, total cost of project?
I think cost as well as the fact that the NCDOT project could be tied together with this one gave it some extra oomph in terms of success and bidding, or I'm sorry, success on grant applications.
Okay.
Did Ms. Monzingo think this was a good one to pick?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Montgomery, McIntosh.
And we talked about this when we were up in Washington recently. It was very well received. I think it was considered that we put together a very good package, and we got a lot of traction on it, so I think our chances are probably pretty good.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Sounded familiar, didn't it? Sounded like last year.
Do I have a motion?
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise, and I will abstain on this one at the moment. That concludes. I'm only a half hour in. I'm doing okay. The consent. We will now go to the general agenda. There are eight items.
Eight.
So we will start with number G1. Secretary will read that.
Item G1, consideration of actions related to public assembly and recreation projects. A, ordinance amending the project budget ordinance for the city of Winston-Salem, North Carolina for the fiscal year 2015-2016. B, resolution approving the change order for renovation work at the Benton Convention Center. C, resolution approving the construction contract for Salem Lake Park. D, resolution awarding a construction contract for Rupert Bell Park.
Okay. If everyone will look in your book on page 2, which is the back page of what she just read, are the projects under the current bond program that we're looking for additional funds? Does anyone have any questions or comments here? Mr. Turner, I guess I'll address this to you, then. I see Ms. Saunders is here also. We are just getting into the bond projects, and some are further along than others. But we're already up to $5 million in add-ons. Any feel for how much longer the list is going to get over time, I guess is what I'm concerned about.
Mr. Chairman, this totals about $3.9 million, and there's another $1.3 million it would be held in contingency.
Okay.
So we're not quite at 5 million. The answer to your question, though, is that there are a vast majority of the projects have already started construction.
Or been bid, at least, so we know what their cost is.
Correct. Okay. So we know what their prices are. There are several that are out there, mostly in the recreation area, that because they either needed to have redesign or design started later or they were in the planning phase earlier on, we're now getting to the point where we realize, yes, we could build them for the amount of money that's available, mm-hmm. but that wouldn't be what we feel the council and the community want. Mm-hmm. So in the introduction to this item, I talked about typical value engineering and then aggressive value engineering. And if
yep.
we apply that aggressive value engineering to get it down to what we have available, we don't think it would deliver the product that you as council and the community want. So the reason for this additional request is to deal with market factors and scope changes that have affected the price of the project.
Okay, thank you. Any questions or comments from anyone? Is there a motion to approve?
Move for approval.
Second. We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is approved. We will now go to G2. Ms. Secretary.
Item G2, resolution approving modifications to the 2007 Reimbursement Assistance Incentive Agreement with Wake Forest University Health Sciences for Wake Forest Innovation Quarter.
Mr. Page, I will give you the floor to explain this to us.
Okay. Good afternoon, Chairman Clark, members of the committee. This item was actually discussed last month as a memo and bringing it back this month for an action item. If you do decide to take action on this and move it forward to City Council, it'll be discussed at a public hearing on your April the 4th agenda. You'll recall that back in November of 2006, Wake Forest University Health Sciences entered into a contract with the city to build 3 new facilities as part of the central district of Wake Forest Innovation Quarter. Those 3 buildings were going to have a taxable value of $47.6 million. For several reasons that I won't go into detail at this point, they have been unable to achieve that investment schedule and have asked for modifications to the 2006 agreement. I don't know if you can actually see this. I'm trying to get a little bit.
It's in our book on page 29.
But this is actually a table showing the original 2007 agreement and the requested modifications that are being requested. The couple that I have highlighted are probably the critical ones or the changes. First of all, the completion date would change from September of 2017 to September of 2027. Secondly, the minimum investment would go from $47.6 million in the central district to $55 million anywhere in the northern district. And I think there is a map in the back of your item that shows what the northern district is. That roughly runs from Business 40 north to Martin Luther King is now the northern district of the park. Also, the minimum square footage would increase from 100,000 square feet of office, laboratory, and light industrial space to at least 150,000 square feet of office, laboratory, and light industrial space. As far as the guaranteed taxability period, it's 20 years for both, plus we get an additional 5 years for any existing buildings in the original agreement, which in essence is the Dean Building. And then the last revision or modification is that any square footage in the minimum capital investment, the 150,000 square feet, that includes residential, and the residential does not meet the 2015 city workforce housing guidelines, there'd be a 10% reduction of the incentive payment. And that 10% is on the entire amount. So that, in essence, would be $484,000 would be the penalty if they were not to provide workforce housing as part of the 150,000 square feet, if they, in fact, did do any residential. So again, that's sort of the modifications that are being requested for your consideration. Happy to answer any questions. And representatives from the research park are here.
Let me ask a quick question. In our book is a color map, and one of them is entitled Central District, which is kind of from 3rd Street to I-40. And then on the next page, it's called the North District, but it incorporates that area plus the North. So has the definition of the North changed?
Yes, the district, I think Mr. Thompson explained last month that actually what happened was the fire marshals or the fire department asked that the districts, you have a northern and a southern district,
yeah,
because it was confusing. So in essence, what they've done is they've gone from Business 40 North as the northern district,
yeah,
and Business 40 South as the southern district, and there is no central district.
Okay. Okay. We discussed this last month. We have the official stuff behind it, or tonight. Ms. Montgomery, you had your hand up.
Yep. One, in concept, I don't have an issue with the plan itself. It's an extension, and I think we build in certain things, but I'm sure everybody knows where my questions are going to come to, and that is in reference to point number five, which is in reference to the square footage and the affordable housing components that exist there. And then it's tied back into the second point about the minimum square footage components there. The 150,000 square footage that's listed here, that includes specifically saying that if in that 150,000 square feet they do housing, that it has to apply to that. But if in the other 100,000 square foot that is stated that will be developed, if it is done in that, then this does not apply to that. Is correct. That correct?
That is correct.
And that, therefore, is problematic for me in the sense that I don't believe that other square footage development would be as successful without this component. Thus, the wording that states that it's not incentivized, I think it is incentivized because we're helping support the other components. So I think we're getting somewhere, but I don't think we're getting all the way to the place, because I believe it still provides an escape from not having workforce housing within the area. And I don't necessarily think that's the intent of everybody to do that, but I'm just saying that that still provides that. But we're not going to do it in this square footage, but we're going to do it
over
in
here,
this square footage. Which,
okay, I think we know the question. Would either one of the gentlemen, Braden or Eric? Braden, if you'll give your name and address for the record, please.
Graydon Pleasants, 1800 Greenbrier Road. Good afternoon. So I'm not sure I do follow the question. We're incenting 150,000 square feet as a part of the new expanded commitment to build in that district, correct? And if any part of that incented square footage is built, then, and it is done as housing, then it would be workforce housing or a penalty. Beyond that, it's a market decision because that's space that's not incented by this agreement. So we're a little reluctant to commit to something that we know little about relative to the future market orientation of other developments beyond the 150,000 feet. Does that answer your question?
I understand that. And so, but what I'm getting at is that other development thus is not as, doesn't make as much sense without that, without the other component of it. So my question is thus, is there no way to have that commitment for that additional square footage at all? Is that not at all?
I don't think.
Am I making sense to
folks? Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead. Let Mr. Pleasants respond.
Yeah, and I think I'm not sure we're in a position to do that. So, I mean, maybe I'm misunderstanding your concept, but what we're here to talk about is the incented square footage, and that's what we're prepared to commit to. It puts us in an awkward position to have to commit beyond that square footage that we're already committing to in terms of the incentive. So it's getting terms of this agreement into future development that are really not a party to this agreement. That's our issue.
But of the total 250,000 square feet, at this point, it can be office, retail, or residential.
it can be whatever those words are up there that I can't read.
Well, I'm reading. It says feet of office, laboratory, light, industrial. So it's not necessarily even going to be housing.
Right.
But you're saying if part of that 250,000, if 150 of the 250 is housing, then you'll go along with the
workforce housing.
Right. What you're saying is you don't know yet what the other 100 is going to be.
It was, you know, it's all speculative at this point. You know, it's very subjective to what market conditions will allow. So if the market comes with a heavy housing component, then there could be housing there. But our intention is to focus on more knowledge, community value creation with office and laboratory development. That's really what that area needs to have.
In which case there'd be no housing.
In case there'd be no housing.
Well, okay. And just to that, and I would say to be fair, and I'm looking back in the back here on another item we have at Mr. Reese, on the parking deck, we put in the same thing on there in terms of if there's housing that's on that component, then that has to be done. And so I want to be fair across the board to anybody we're asking to do anything in community on the same point. I want to support this, and I really do, but it will cause me some heartburn if, in fact, 5 years from now, I see a development and there's housing that comes on, and that was the intention, and we don't have workforce housing components in that, and we provided the scapegoat in the process to do that, which, and I say all this that, and if anybody is perplexed at my question today, I hope you're not, because this has been my question and concern the entire time, so I hope you're not if you are.
Ms. Long?
Just clarification, if you will. I'm seeing nowhere anything about 250,000 square feet.
Excuse me, it's 152.
Okay, and so
it's 100 to 150. So the project's 100 to 150.
The obligation
increase.
Yes, yeah. Right. And it is meant as office, laboratory, and so on. So, in fact, if there is any other development that does include residential, any development that is not office, laboratory, or light industrial, then would that not kick in our requirement for workforce housing?
Actually, you brought up a good point. The agreement only calls for 150,000 square feet total.
Yeah.
And they're committing that if any of that 150 is housing, it will be
workforce.
Yeah. Right. Right. Meet the guidelines.
Meet the guidelines.
Yeah. Right, but and if I may, the third point, and on mine is page 24.
Yeah.
If you go down, it says to increase the minimal cap investment requirement from 100,000 to 150,000 square feet of office space, laboratory, and light industrial space by September 10th, 2027, and to increase the total capital investment from 200,000 to 250,000 square feet with the addition of 50,000 square feet of mixed-use space not incentivized and 200,000 square feet to be office, laboratory, and light industrial use.
Yeah, but this agreement only, if you go to page 29.
It only includes the 150, which is my point about it. It only includes 150, thus that's the point of the question about the other component of space. Could that be used for housing? Is that yet to be developed space already done?
Mr. Page, you're up there. Can you shed some light here?
So what Councilman Montgomery is referring to is they've increased the minimum investment from 100 to 150. There is another 100,000 square feet of potential development that is not part of the incentive agreement, but they're saying we may do this. And that is sort of the area that Councilman Montgomery is inquiring about. What happens about that 100,000 square feet if it's in fact developed and it is residential, should it include workforce housing? I think is the question that Councilman Montgomery is asking.
I think you've... Okay.
Yes, thank you. Again, I know all of it is speculative on that other 100,000, but to Councilmember Montgomery's point, why couldn't we, and I don't know what Mr. Page, whether we've done this before, I think maybe we have, why can't we put it in there speculative, just like they're speculative about whether housing could be there? Because if it does, and using our assistance to improve the project, to make it a valid project that people want to come and be a part of and live in, and all of a sudden we got another housing boom, which we're having downtown, that housing does go there, then why shouldn't it be a part of the equation, I say? That's my 2 cents.
Eric Tomlinson, good evening.
Tomlinson, excuse me.
So the proposed amendment here keys off the 2007 agreement, which was for 200,000 square feet of new development with an obligation for a minimum of 100,000 square feet. And if we were not able to perform and produce that 100,000 square feet of development, then penalty clauses would kick in. This revised agreement calls for 250,000 square feet of new development, and the performance obligation is for 150,000 square feet. So I just wanted to clarify that point that Mr. Page made.
Any other questions, comments?
I'm just going to make an observation. You know, I'm one of the cheerleaders for the project, and I can understand what the councilperson is saying, but I also want us to keep in mind that certain things may limit certain things. And I would not want us in any way for this project not to move forward. And when we do things like this, I always say, look at what the city gives and look what tax base comes back. So can somebody tell me actually how much money we'll be spending and how much money they've been spending on this project? You have the figure?
We'll get those numbers for you, Councilman Burke.
Okay.
I believe, Mr. Page, you sent me, I don't know if others got it, several months ago, one-page summary of the research part.
I know. Anytime I ask you a question, but the public may not know. Well,
you have
discussions like this. Sometimes they see one side of the picture. What we know, sometimes they don't know.
May I give the number?
Yeah, go ahead.
So since 2007, there have been $420 million of inward investment into the Innovation Court in terms of facilities and about $140 million of infrastructure.
And I have one other question now. Dr. Thomason, the concern that the council person has about the workforce, if it got to that point, what would be your opinion? You've moved the project so far, and you've had a certain commitment, and we've had a lot of trust and confidence with each other. So what would you, he won't have that hanging in his head that made the...
Right, I think it's implausible that there will not be workforce housing in the Innovation Quarter, and increasingly so. That is the lifeblood of what we do.
Thank you. Mr. Page, if you could include additional information on what has taken place, would be helpful for all of us.
Okay.
Do I have a motion?
Well, Mr. Chairman, it seems like I'm going to move it to the committee without...
We have a motion to move it to the council without a recommendation. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Did you want to say something, Mr.
Chairman? Yeah, if it goes to council as it is, the way it is now, I will have to respectfully not support it. Not that I don't support the project and don't support this, but I think that if we've made certain commitments as a community, as a city, we have to stand firm on certain principles or on what we want to include. And it's not standing in the way of a certain piece of project. We can say we want to support projects and we don't want to stand in the way of certain business interests coming in and doing that. But then we look in retrospect and say, hey, I wish we had done that, because now we don't have what it is that we wanted to have. And so if you don't have these conversations up front, then we end up with something that is not totally inclusive for everyone in our community. And so I think it is, if we believe we're going to do it, then I don't see why it's hard to commit to doing what we say we think we're going to do anyway. And if that's hard to do, then I find some challenges there. And we're doing certain things, and I've sent a couple emails out to the city manager, the mayor, Mr. Brooks, and others about nationally some of the issues that we have around housing and the dollar amount of accessing, because we're not the only one dealing with it. And so we have to do something and be very, very clear on what we're doing, in every part of the city if we want to be serious about it. And if we don't, then tell me to shut up and be quiet. That's not what we want to do.
Yes, sir. Okay. Ms. Thompson?
Let me say that we would be prepared to have language along the lines of we would be prepared to use our best efforts for such a such development. Okay.
All right. We have a motion to send this forward without recommendation to the council. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstaining? So we have 3 in favor, 1 opposed, no abstaining. That is G2. We will now go to G3.
Item G3, consideration of items related to a capital improvement project and the city to engage in a public-private partnership. A, resolution finding there is a critical need for a capital improvement project and for the city to engage.
Mr. Page, excuse me. Okay. Keep going.
In a public-private partnership in accordance with General Statutes 143-128.1C in the amount of $4 million.
I think the first significant investment by the city into the Whitaker Park rehab project. Mr. Page, if you'll give us maybe a 2-minute speech.
Also, the first time, Chairman Clark, that we've ever used the public-private partnership statute 143-128-1C. So it's a little bit different than what we've typically done as an economic development project, but we'd be entering into a public-private partnership. Under that, the city has identified a critical need to install and enhance infrastructure in the Whitaker Park development. To help spur economic development in the southern or the northern part of the city. Whitaker Park has potential to redevelop into a mixed-use development project that at build-out could create up to 7,500 jobs and more than $100 million in investment, which can net about $565,000 annually in new city property taxes. Under 143-128-1C, the city can engage in a public-private partnership. And as such, the city would do several things. We would acquire easements for installation and maintenance of public water and sewer infrastructure. We would acquire right-of-ways for road expansion and connectivity purposes. And we'll provide a secured loan to a private developer to repurpose and make tenant-ready several buildings within Whitaker Park. As part of the public-private partnership statute, the city must find a critical need for the capital improvement project, which this resolution accomplishes. In 2015, R.J. Reynolds Tobacco announced that they would donate a large portion of the Whitaker Park campus, which is about 125 acres and 1.7 million square feet, to the Whitaker Park Development Authority, which is a nonprofit entity doing economic development and redevelopment purposes. It's likely that Whitaker Park Development Authority will submit a response to the request for qualifications, which the city must issue pursuant to 143-128-1C for redevelopment. To undertake the work, Whitaker Park Development Authority is requesting $4 million financial assistance from both the city and the county, as the estimates for the work will exceed $8 million. If approved, the city would use general obligation bond funds. As proposed, Whitaker Park Development Authority would use up to $2 million of the city's $4 million for its private enhancements in several buildings in the park. These funds will provide a secured, low-interest, market-rate loan to Whitaker Park Development Authority. The rate will be based on prime plus 1%, but in no case would it be less than 3%, no greater than 5%. The loan will be paid in full if the buildings that are sold as collateral are sold. If the buildings are leased, the city will receive a pro rata share of the lease payment to satisfy the city's loan. All funds repaid to the city would be available for future economic development projects as determined by City Council. The remaining $2 million would be used to compensate Whitaker Park Development Authority for the fair market value of real estate conveyed to the city, along with the necessary infrastructure improvements, including water, roads, water, and sewer. It's anticipated that all the buildings will be fully taxable, thus there'll be no adverse impact of removing taxable properties from the tax rolls. And the new property tax generated by the enhancement will far exceed the city's investment. upon the finding of the City Council of a critical need of the improvement project as set forth in the attached resolution, the city will begin the request for qualifications process and negotiate a tentative contract with the successful developer for public consumption and public council and City Council approval following a public hearing.
Thank you. Mr. Leek, are you here for this item?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any comments you would like to make?
No, sir, but I'm here for questions.
Thank you. So, Mr. Page, to summarize, it's a $4 million request. $2 million is going to invest into buildings, which will be a low-interest loan, and we will receive a return from either lease payments or the sale of the property.
Correct.
The other $2 million is infrastructure improvements, roads, water, sewer, et cetera.
Yes, sir.
Is any of the infrastructure coming from the utilities budget?
No, this would be sources that are not funded from elsewhere.
Okay, thank you very much. And the county is doing a comparable
commitment.
Okay. Any questions, comments? Mr. Montgomery?
Will there be participation from Utilities Commission?
They are having discussions. I don't know if that's been decided yet.
But we're basically matching the county's commitment is what we're doing here. Mr. Leek would now like to comment.
Mr. Chairman, Robert Leek, 1080 West 4th Street, Winston-Salem, 27101. In relation to that, we have been approaching approaching the Utilities Commission to handle the public portion of water and sewer installation that the county's loan agreement will pay for. So they will bid it in the public process and do it the proper way. But it will not be additional funds, not same funds, if that makes any sense.
Okay. So if the county comes in for the Utilities Commission is on top of that.
What the county will do is pay the Utilities Commission back for public infrastructure that's different from the infrastructure and the right-of-way that's being discussed here today.
So you're really just using the Utilities Commission as a path through the county money?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Ms. Burke, do you have a question?
I just think it's a positive project. When you look at it up there, an area that was really going down near Polo and Indiana, and then to see what Wake Forest is doing up there, and then to take Critical Park and give it some life, which will produce jobs and opportunities, I see as something that's possible.
Thank you. And I would like to recognize that Councilman Adams sits on the Whitaker Park Development Authority. Just for the record, Mr. McIntosh.
Just a technical question. When we collect property taxes here, is it based on property value or is it based on income generated?
Based on property values.
Property value, okay.
Now, how they value it may be based on income, but right. It is based on the value of the property.
Thank you.
I would just like to echo, I think this is a wonderful project. When Whitaker Park closed, and as it was closing, that part of town felt a great sucking noise. The reason Bell Brothers closed and Simo's closed and a lot of the small office buildings out in North Point area are now empty is because thousands and thousands of people and businesses that used to revolve around Whitaker Park are no longer there. And this is the first step towards it. I truly thank R.J. Reynolds or Reynolds America for doing this, and I think this is will be similar to the Research Park where a small public investment will leverage and will be a catalyst for hopefully a lot of great things, and Ms. Adams will look after our interests to be sure they're done properly. Yes, ma'am.
And Councilmember Bessie, Mayor, correct me if I'm wrong. Didn't we have an item at the TAC meeting this past week relevant to roads and Highway 52 with Whitaker Park? So it's not just the city of Winston-Salem and the county. And now we have TAC, which is part of the state, DOT and everything, going forward to help make this project and this process work for Winston-Salem. So I see it as a positive. Again, we got collaborative partnerships among all of us. So I'm looking forward and excited as we move forward on it. And yes, I will take care of it.
Would you make a motion to approve this?
I move that we consider item G3.
All right. There's a motion to approve G3.
Second.
We have a second. Any other comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is approved and sent forward. We will, and that's G3A and B. Get them both approved. We'll now go to G4.
Item G4, resolution authorizing the sale of the Center City West parking deck and the Holly Avenue surface parking lot under the upset bid procedure of North Carolina General Statutes 168-269, located in the Northwest Ward in the amount of $2,275,000.
I do not see Mr. Moreland here. Mr. Turner, would you please? This is the infamous parking deck. Oh, see back? Oh, there you are. Well, whoever would like to speak?
Yeah, he's sitting right there.
Mr. Turner, I'll call on you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, back in February of 2014, I believe, the committee started work on this. 2015. And so you've been at it for what seems like 2014, but you've been at it since 2015. And the committee has eventually come to it some recommendations for conditions for the sale of this deck. We went through the upset bid process after council approved those conditions on the sale, and we now have a offer from Club Oak Partners LLC. They have actually partnered with a previous bidder, Tightline Partners LLC, and are requesting that the offer of the high bidder be awarded to the new consolidated partnership, which is called Center City West LLC, and that they be authorized to purchase the deck at the high bid price. There's one other item in your pack at your places, and that's some revised language for conditions for the sale, and all it does is it makes parking available for the baseball facility in the deck to the extent that it's available while the new owner has control of it.
Okay.
Be happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
I see Mr. Reese is here. John, would you come forward? Can you give us just a little brief thing of what you folks have planned? Because one of the keys, I think, all along to this sale was to use the deck as a catalyst.
Yes,
and
it was.
20 years ago, it was used as a catalyst, and at that time, it was Wachovia Bank. Now it's Wells Fargo. Took the old Sears store and converted it, and also what was the parking deck on 4.5 Street, Wells Fargo also put up probably a 6-story building there, I believe, something like that. But as times have changed and what they do in those buildings has become much more automated, they do not need as much space. So now we can repurpose it, and if you'll kind of tell us what you got in mind.
John Reese, 751 West 4th Street, 27101. It does seem like it's been since 2014, Greg, but we've been working on this for a long time. We really feel that this current situation is a win-win-win. You're combining two local developers. The Club Oaks Group has extensive local experience in developing hospitality, retail, and multifamily. Our experience has been primarily developing office. 751 is an example of that. So we think the combined entity has greater resources, has greater experience in bringing more, or at least considering new and different options. Those properties highlighted in yellow as future development total about 2.5 acres. Those are sites that we own. Emphasize we own. They're not under contract. We control, we own. And prepared to put those in service as soon as possible.
Do you have additional handouts you could give us on this? Or is that the only one you brought?
Nothing other than the...
do you have more copies of that?
I do. Only two more.
That's fine. If you could just leave one with us.
No, we'll distribute it with
actually
the packet, Mr. Chairman.
Well.
Oh, okay. Is it in the packet?
No, we will distribute it with the packet.
Okay, so that map will be in the packet.
Okay.
Would you mind pointing out on that where your where the deck is currently? I can't read that. Okay, that's it. Okay.
Subject deck here, and this is our new 751 office building,
yes.
And here are the sites that we own.
Okay. Okay. Are there any questions, comments? I see Mr. Montgomery's hand up first.
Oh, first is a question about the other partners within that. Who are the other partners?
It is a local investment group, Sheets and Smith.
Okay.
Based here in Winston-Salem.
Okay.
Okay.
And other is just, I think at the beginning of the conversation, it was, you know, what's the best interest of citizens and community as we look at development. I think at the end of the day now we've gotten to a point where it's very clear, and I think I look forward to the development that will come from this project.
Thank you.
Mr. McIntosh?
I'm going to play a little inside baseball here and just talk about my ward and how happy I am that we're going to get a big shot of development in the ward. And I think this is an area that ties into the baseball stadium and all the excitement and all the resources we put into that. And we're seeing the payback from that. I think this will have future knock-on effects to bring more development to the area. So I applaud the efforts. I know the bidding process got a little crazy, and I think next time, if there is a next time, we could have worded the proposals a little, the bid requirements a little more clearly. But all in all, I'm very happy, and I'm excited to see this happen. And I think it's going to kick off some other good things on Holly Avenue and that surrounding area. So I look forward to working with you guys on it.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
John, it looks like you'd already committed to $21 million investment there on that one site. Am I right to assume that probably going to the amount of investment is going to end up being more?
There's a good chance. We're also pursuing additional sites in that immediate area and are at various stages of progress with those efforts as well. Yeah, absolutely. We're better prepared now to satisfy all of the development requirements in this partnership.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Do I have a motion to approve?
I move for approval.
Second. We have a motion and a second on G4. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. That is approved. Mr. Turner, you too. This will be on the general agenda Monday night, so you'll be aware of that.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I was going to ask, but they moved so quickly past the vote. I was going to ask Ms. Reese if you want the same deal they requested, that we would change the language from you were required to have the workforce housing to maybe want to try to do the workforce housing on it. But
no, I'm prepared.
I was joking with that.
You avoided that political trap. All right. Mr. Montgomery behaves. All right. We'll now go to G5.
Item G5, resolution authorizing and directing the city manager to perform due diligence work on a library site and economic development project for the Lucia site on Wattown Street.
Mr. Turner, I think you're still up. Would you give us a brief comment here on what we're doing?
Certainly, Mr. Chairman. We've been approached about the possibility of an economic development and library partnership project where the city would acquire the property and then provide the land to the county for the construction of a library, and the city would build economic development, commercial shops, et cetera, on a portion of the land. The site is the building to the west of the police district that we're currently building on Wattown Street at the old Lucia site. The site is actually part of the Lucia parcel. There would be approximately 10,000 square feet of library plus other supplemental development. There's a map or a conceptual diagram in your agenda book. What we're asking for, well, I should say we've done some preliminary work on the project and estimations. We estimate the project would be approximately $1 million in city investment, but in order to better give you more accurate estimates of how that breaks down and what the true cost might be, we feel it would be appropriate for the council to authorize some additional due diligence work, and so the item in front of you would authorize and direct the manager to do that due diligence.
Do we know who would do the due diligence and what it would cost?
It would be done by a combination of city staff and potential consultants.
Okay.
Depending on what we find in the early phases would determine whether we need to bring in consultants for things like soil testing or underground testing, things like that.
Okay. I guess I'm just concerned there's no budget number in here.
If, in fact, it would be over $100,000, obviously we'd be coming back to council for approval of that. We wouldn't anticipate that at this point.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Burke?
Yes, I think that in doing a project like this, we need to be consistent. If somebody by chance comes from another area and they would like the same type of consideration, Mr. City Manager, what steps will we take? It's not unusual for us to swap land to do things as far as schools, and we've done it with playgrounds, we've done it with school property. But I want us to be consistent. So what will we do? Like somebody will come up and say, well, I went over there and I feel we need to have a library. Because we keep in mind, libraries are social are concerns that the county, from our county tax dollars.
Thank you, Councilman Burke. Any council member can bring a request forward to myself. and to my staff, and we review it and look at the options. Before we move very far, though, we do bring it forward to this council, which is what we're doing today. If we proceed with this after due diligence, my thought is this would be a small version of what you just saw previously of a public-private partnership, where obviously the city wouldn't be building all of the private development. We'd be partnering with the private developer, and the county would also have to agree, and they have at least said they'll look at it, agree to lease the land and build a 10,000 square foot library. So a lot of work still to be done before any decision packages of actually spending any major money would come back.
Ms. Burke, go ahead.
Yes, I was over there the other day, and I want to commend the councilman. It looks good over there. You see the buildings being developed. You see people coming and going. Everything looks clean in the areas that I was in. And I don't want you to think that I'm against this project. It's just that when we do a project, I think we need to be consistent and make the public aware of what we're about and give that same consideration to someone else. I say again, it looks very nice. And you can tell that's been a lot of work in that particular area with the businesses that are developing and the people. Things are looking much cleaner, more upbeat.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor. Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I was just going to say that I commend Councilman for his hard work on this, and that I think it follows the general trend that other towns and cities in the county have done in providing sites for the county to do a library on. So we're kind of following that same trend here, and the fact that the city's already got an investment in that police substation to create a critical mass. So it appears to have some good merit to me, and I think we can zero in on it here, get the cost tied down. It looks good.
Ms. Lighton and Mr. McIntosh. Ms. Lighton.
Will someone, maybe Council Member Taylor, look at this page?
This is a photo.
Yes, ma'am.
Aerial photo.
Where is the police station, and where is what we're talking about now? Which is, I'm turned around.
Here.
This is the police station, I believe.
Greg's going to put it on.
Greg's going to put it on the
There we go. How good are your eyes?
Not that good.
Mine aren't either. Here we go.
Police district, and we're talking about this parcel right here.
Okay. And what are the bike lanes?
Other factories or other remnants of the factory.
What you have is different colored roofs.
With nothing planned for that.
Just the southern portion or the bottom portion of the dark building, but nothing in the light roofed buildings.
Okay. All right. Thank you. That turned around.
It would be helpful to maybe have a ground photo, some street shots of this.
We'll be happy to bring that back.
Okay, thank you. Ms. McIntosh. Councilman, coming around the table.
I talked about this in the past, and I think he knows that I support this. As we put together this package, just from a structural standpoint, my preference would be to not have the city be an owner of this space that we're building, this commercial space, that we partner with private sector, and that our dollars be used to send somebody to come along. And I don't know that we really are the best entity to own that commercial space on a long-run basis.
Okay. Mr. Taylor?
Yeah, I just want to say I appreciate all of the council members' comments and support. I think that this is a good opportunity for a great economic development project in the southeastern portion of the city. We've talked about it in the northwest. We've talked about it in the north today. And, you know, ultimately, this is a part of a larger particular investment where we partner with the county for the library. We also partner with some folks in the community, possibly the Simon Jack and CDC and other entities to provide that economic development that we so desperately need. But the city has invested a number of dollars into the roads. If we put the map back up, which was just taken down, right in the elbow of the property that we saw.
Hang on a minute, let him get that back.
If you look right in the elbow of all of the particular housing properties on the right-hand side of the project, right in the elbow, you don't see any houses there. Actually, there's a trail, proposed Walltown Connector Trail, that we're spending $1 million on to connect this particular project to the quarry part, where we're looking at another $4 million worth of investment. That trail will also lead to Salem Lake, where we're looking at roughly another $4 million of investment, and also with some of our spray grounds and parks. So this all ties into the goal and the objectives that the council has set to provide economic development opportunities for areas outside of downtown. It's good to promote downtown and to provide for downtown, but some of the projects we voted on today, and this project included, will provide that economic development boost for the communities outside of downtown. So overall, it's a good deal. We'll go back, we'll get the numbers hammered down, and not only for the portions of the facility, it also gives us the opportunity to have some additional development in the back portion of the facility. So it's a good project. The community supports it, and I appreciate the support from the committee and for the council at large.
Mr. Montgomery, do you have a comment?
He said it all.
Ms. Adams.
Yes, thank you. It is a good project. And what it does, too, is all of these projects, let's say, that lend itself outside of the center core of the city, particularly our new police districts that are going up, it gives them to have a chance to have a presence in the community. But now you're also talking about putting children and families near that district station, which lends itself to some cooperative relationships, some volunteerism, some community activities and whatever. So I think it's a win-win, again, when we're looking at community development, to ensure, as we said, that the critical mass does what it's supposed to do, is bringing people together. And I think this is one of those projects that will.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a personal comment.
You go right ahead.
I failed to mention, whether it's controversial or not, the Haynes facility that was located, I think, in Councilmember Brooks' ward, the students, for one reason or the other, were brought over to the Old Hill Middle School site, which was once vacant, broken windows and things of that nature. Those students, what I understand, are still occupying that facility, which will have good range to this particular library. Also, in 2009, 2010, when I first came on the council, there was a group of people that we led to lead the fight. On the left-hand side of the facility, there's a particular post office. Well, the federal government was talking about closing this post office. We really went to war. We fought back, and we were able to keep that post office. So there's so many moving parts and components to this economic development deal. It's not just a library. Again, right. It's a part of a larger community complex, for lack of a better term, that's necessary for the community.
Ms. Burke, do you have a comment?
Well, he mentioned the Haynes-Lawrence, and at the public safety meeting, we'll have a little more serious discussion about the public safety and health welfare of the citizens there. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I would make two brief comments on this. One, I will support the motion today because I do think it's important to know what you're dealing with. I do have two concerns about this. One is the precedent setting of the city getting into the library business. And I think if we do this one, we can count on five or six more. Wait a minute, how many wards are there? Eight? Two of them have libraries, three of them have libraries, so five more. Secondly, and it's to reinforce what Mrs. McIntosh says, I think these things work when we partner with somebody who knows what they're doing and who has skin in the game. And while I will not go over them tonight, there are certain things that we have partnered with that have worked very well. We've just talked about the research part. And certain things that haven't. And the ones that haven't worked is when we did not get the appropriate partner who was in it. I do have major concerns with the city taking ownership of the buildings and getting into the retail development business. But I would welcome a partner. And I don't know if it's the person that owns the property now or who it may be, and that's something that we will learn as we get into it. Having said that, is there a motion to approve?
I move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion, a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise, that is approved. We will now go to G6.
Item G6, a resolution adopting financial policies and recommendations regarding city funds for the city of Winston-Salem.
Ms. Saunders, if you'll give us a two-minute introduction.
Sure.
And
sure.
I'm way ahead of schedule.
Great. Good afternoon, Councilmember Clark, Mayor, and members of the City Council. The attached resolution relates to formal financial policies of the city of Winston-Salem. As you recall, back in February 2014, City Council formally adopted financial policies for the city. And under City Council's guidance, those policies and practices have allowed the city to maintain a AAA bond rating. And I'll add that last week we sold general obligation bonds, and all three credit rating agencies affirmed our AAA rating. We sold the bonds, again, at historically low rates, so right around 2.8% all-in cost. So that's very good, and as a result of the strong financial policies of the city. At the end of June 30th, 2015, the city increased the unassigned general fund balance, and there's no current policy of what to do with that increase. If you recall back in the financial policies passed in 2014, we're required to keep an unassigned general fund balance of 12.5%. So what I'm recommending is that we increase the unassigned general fund balance policy to 14% of the estimated expenditures, as well as transfer an annual increase in unassigned fund balance to the Housing Finance Assistance Fund and the Economic Development Projects Fund at an amount equal to 25% each of that annual increase, and the remaining 50% would stay in the general fund. If City Council were to approve these recommendations, they would be included in the budget for fiscal year 2017. As well as during the last February Finance Committee, several members asked questions about cash investments of the city, debt outstanding, and financial services vendors. Those have been listed as an attachment in Exhibit B if you have any questions.
There's quite a few attachments back there.
In addition to the fund balance
policy.
Which is good.
I appreciate that. And I'm glad to hear we were able to all in at 2.8%. That's a phenomenal borrowing rate. So what we're saying is really three items here. We're going to be moving the general fund balance to 14%. And anything above that, 50% would be kept in. And the other 50 would be split 25% each between housing fund and economic development.
Right.
That's correct.
Fund.
Any questions, comments? Mr. Bessie, do you have your hand?
No, I'm doubly confused.
It's numbers. I'm not.
Yes. Right. No. I know that. Okay.
It's more money for you to spend, Mr. Bessie.
What will actually be the percentage kept in the uncommitted funds? Is it going to be 13% or 14%?
14%.
14%.
So there's a ceiling of 14% always that's going to be kept in the unassigned.
Isn't that a floor?
Floor.
It's a floor, not a ceiling.
Floor. I'm sorry. Yes, okay. Floor. Floor. Not a ceiling. Floor.
And, you know, where does the funding come from that goes into the other two funds?
The increase. So at the end of a fiscal year, I would look at what the increase was from the prior year and the unassigned fund balance. So, for example, last year, our increase in unassigned fund balance was $2,894,000. Of that, we'd take 50% of, which is $1,447,000, leave that in the general fund, and then we'd split $723,609. One would go to Housing Finance Assistance, the other would go to the Economic Development Project Fund.
And at what time does that go to those funds?
In this particular year, I'm suggesting we do it in next budget year since we're so close to that budget process. But what we could do is as soon as the audit was complete, which is usually September, October every year, we could bring back an amendment shortly thereafter and go ahead and appropriate it. It's just timing. Or we could do it as an amendment now. But my suggestion was just to do it as part of the budget process at this particular time.
Right. So what I'm trying to be clear on is whether that's coming out at the end of the fiscal year. So we have had that amount in the unassigned balance for the year. We haven't needed it.
Right.
And so that's when we're taking half of what's left in the unassigned balance.
It is based on what's at the end of that year, correct?
Because we won't know what the balance is till the end of the year.
Right.
That's right.
And so is this a are we approving a recurring action that continues until and unless we change it, or are we approving a one-time action for this year?
You're approving a recurring action.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure I was clear on.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And I will say, from time to time, we do go to the surplus in the general fund to fund various things.
Correct.
We don't do it every day, but we do it periodically.
Right.
Okay. Any questions or comments on this one? I hear a motion to approve.
I move for approval, item G6.
Second. We have a motion to second on G6. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. We will now go to G7.
Item G7, request from the Ujima Community Development Corporation for the development of a 50-foot senior housing rental development to be known as Emmanuel Retirement Village.
Mr. Brooks, will you give us a two-minute on this one?
Sure will. Good afternoon, Chairman Clark, Mayor Pro Tem, members of council.
Yes, no.
The city has received a request from Ujima Community Development Corporation to construct a 50-unit planned senior housing rental development on Barbara Jane Avenue. It's to be known as Emmanuel Retirement Village. It will consist of a two-story multifamily structure containing 28 one-bedroom units, 11 duplex structures containing 22 bedroom units, and a community center for the complex's residents. The unit size will be 684 square feet for one bedroom and 960 square feet for two bedrooms. The market rate rents will be $899 per month for a one bedroom and $950 for a two bedroom unit. The CDC has agreed to provide 10% of the units for affordable housing for households earning 80% of the area median income. And that would be consisting of 3 one-bedroom units renting at $784 per month and 2 two-bedroom units consisting of $899 per month. And these affordability restrictions on the units would be recorded as a deed restriction to ensure compliance. The CDC has a volunteer board. They receive capacity building and funding support from the Winston-Salem Community Development Support Collaborative, which disbanded in June 2015, but their offices are located in the Enterprise Center on Martin Luther King Boulevard, and they received a host of services in that particular facility. And as you know, the city has a substantial investment in that particular building. We have audited 3-year financial statements showing an operating budget of approximately $20,000 a year, and that's derived primarily from grants and small contributions. It does not appear that there's a line of credit or any working capital, so however. This would be the CDC's first project, and they've used a development consultant to assist with the feasibility, financial feasibility, and pre-development activities, and just to help plan the construction, the project. They were awarded a grant of $70,000 in FY13 to assist with pre-development activities such as preparations, drawings, and plans, and they have they have been trying since that time to pull this project together. So today we have a total projected cost of $5,481 and some change, and the funding sources would consist of bank financing and a requested city financing of 2.5, and that's outlined here for you. The local bank loan is considering an interim loan of up to $300,000 for the project, and that loan can only be used for construction costs. It's a 5-year loan, and the CDC will refinance it at that time. The city's financing would be subordinate to the interim construction loan, and we would agree to subordinate to the new permanent financing subject to our review of the terms of that particular financing. And as you know, our funds are used as gap funds, so the final rate will be backed into. When we originally received the request did not receive The request did not include a debt service payment. It was submitted as a grant, all the funds. However, in order to make this project work, of course, a typical city loan for a market rate project would be 20 years and 2%. However, in order to make this project work, we would need a $2 million loan, and these terms would not meet the city's maximum debt coverage ratio unless it were done at a $1 million loan at 2% interest, deferred for 3 years, and then a 40-year term, and a $1 million loan at 0 interest, deferred and due on sale or transfer of the property. That would make the project feasible. Since the bank loan would only pay for construction, the city's funds would be available for any project costs distributed throughout the project, and what would be a challenge if there are any cost overruns. It is unlikely that the CDC would have funds to cover that, so the city would more than likely have to provide additional funding if that were the case. The proposed funding source with this for this would be general obligation bonds. We have that breakdown of the bonds for you. Mr. Weston is the development consultant that's here and would be available along with other CDC members for any questions that you would have. So we're presenting this project for you today for information and questions, and depending on the direction that we receive from you, we'll move forward with an item for next month.
Thank you. Mr. Brooks just said this is for informational purposes only today. So we need to get any questions, comments, issues we may have, and then he will incorporate all that. So I'll just go around the table. Ms. Adams, you got your hand up?
Yes. I think this is a good project. I appreciate Mr. Brooks and staff for trying to figure out how to do this. I thank the UGMA CDC for diligently sticking with this for so long to try to realize your dream for the community. I asked Mr. Brooks and staff to also provide to council members the locations of our retirement dwellings for our seniors. For most of you that don't know or do know, most of the senior dwellings are in certain parts of the city, and they're not built for poor seniors in the urban core. We now need to start looking at that because people over 60, there are thousands of us getting older every day, and a lot of them don't want to live in their homes anymore either. They want to downsize. And this gives the community, the East Winston or the eastern side of town, to have a facility that is there and comparable, and it's going to have security and a community center, and it'll have healthcare needs stuff on site to be able to live out their days in a good environment. I'm hoping that we can do what we have to do to make this work because, again, we don't have this on the other sides of town, and I think this is a good one partnership for the city of Winston-Salem.
All right, Ms. Burke.
Yes, I agree with the councilwoman, and Emmanuel has worked hard. And it's been a church in this community that's been a positive church, and I want them to know how much I appreciate it. I was over in the area the other week. Our wards run right in there on Old Greensboro Road, and there's been some nice housing there. They're cleaning it up. And, of course, going to do some more cleaning up. But I agree with the councilwoman. People, when they retire, when they need assisted living, they like to live in familiar places.
Absolutely.
And when I look at Trenton and Glen, most folks who live east of 52, they want to go to Trenton and Glen. It's convenient for their relatives and friends. And that did start off to be a minority project.
Correct.
And I would hope that before I get off this council, that somebody would put a minority investor in East Winston, because I do feel that we have the capabilities and we're able. So I commend this project to the councilperson in your ward. It's in yours.
Whose ward is it?
The church is in
your ward.
Yours, right?
This is in the southeast ward.
And the church
is in the southeast, and then the project's in the east.
East ward, okay.
Yes, and the project's in your ward, and I support it.
Thank you. Any other question, Mr. McIntosh?
I would agree with the need for it. A couple of concerns that I would have is the debt ratio. We're 100% financing, and with very little backup, if any backup available, and as a first-time developer, mm-hmm. there'll be some backup needed, I can guarantee. Things don't always go according to plan. Mm-hmm. Even when we have our staff who can do these things day in, day out, we run into situations where we have to go for backup financing. So I would want to see that there is the ability to come up with that, other than just coming back to us for it. Conceptually, I don't have a problem with it, but I think that's a big lift for a first-time developer, $5.5 million.
Ms. Mike.
My question has to do with the fact that this is the source of the funding would be from the general obligation bond. Is this not a heavy drain for one project?
It's taken roughly 41%, is that right, of the housing bonds?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right.
That's just to confirm that it's a
good point.
Big drain.
All right.
And this is just a comment again. Over the years in Winston-Salem, every time we voted on any kinds of bonds, the urban core and the African-American community, we didn't see many projects coming to our communities. We didn't. And we supported them for years. I'm 61, I'll be 62 in a couple of weeks, and I know there have been many bond projects and bonds that came to the city to vote on. Now we're at a point in our lives that I would like to think that our communities are getting, hopefully, we're getting smarter, we're getting more strategic with each other and how we do collaborative partnerships with the community. And when we, again, this is what I caution this council on all the time, when we bring people in here with their projects and development and whatever they got, and it's a great thing for the city of Winston-Salem. Well, when over 40% or more of the people in the city don't even really have an opportunity to partake of these projects because of their economic status in the community, I think we as a group, again, need to be more sensitive to the fact that the bonds that we've just passed, I don't know what everybody else did, but I made a promise to my people in the North Ward that I would do whatever I could to help uplift the least of us in this community with these bonds. Again, we turned out our constituents to vote on these bonds based on the promise that they were going to see something. So now's the time, as the preachers were preaching at Senator Palmer's funeral today, now's the time that we put up or we shut up. That's just the way it is. So, you know, that's all I'm going to say.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
I agree with the council person because through the years we've had bonds. And we have said to the minorities, we want you to support it. And you can go back to the record and see what I have said. The minorities go out and vote. And then when it comes to the opportunities, we don't get them. And we have people in leadership in this community who sit on this council. We have been and we have looked at this, but we have not given east of Winston-Salem a fair share. I speak to the city manager about this more than one time, and I think it's time for us to stop being the voters and for us to be more compassionate and sensitive and stop playing with minority people.
I think Mr. Bessie, then the mayor. Go ahead.
I'm not worried about the percentage of the bonds that this would allocate to a single project. I think it's a good placement of the project. I am worried about the numbers. There's no margin here. There's no margin for error, and this is a first-time developer. I think the numbers are a problem here, and they need to be improved for this to be a good project for us to get this deeply into. You know my record. I back development in parts of our community that need it. I don't want to see us, you know, start into a project that doesn't work. I think we need to work on this some more before it comes back for a vote.
Okay, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, I just wanted to echo comments been made. I remember Ms. Barbara Phillips worked so hard on that project on Waterworks Road, and she never got to see it come to fruition. And it would be great to have a project that our retirees and our seniors could go to there. I think Mr. Weston, I assume you're working on this project, and I have a lot of confidence in Mr. Weston's ability to put together a project that will work. But I think your concerns, Councilor Bessie, is very, very valid, and I would just encourage us all to look at the numbers and make sure they work, but it is a great location and a great placement of the project.
Yes, ma'am.
I cannot let that comment be made without making a comment here. It was Alpha Cap, it's Alpha Cap Alpha Women, and it was a national project. Now, we spent over $1 million. It's because the program who was directing it maybe didn't get some of the what was needed, that sophistication. Nowhere in the world you spend over $1 million and have nothing to show, and then another group comes in, and all that we did to get it zoned.
I was on the council, yeah.
All we did to get it zoned that way, and then somebody else comes in, and they take the project and move forward. So I think with this particular project, if we are sincere about what we ought to do, then if the sophistication we're saying, and you've heard these men over here talk about the MWBE, how we need to fine-tune it, how we need to make work with small businesses, I've said to the city manager, stop playing. Let us use this as an example. Let us take this project and show what we can do to make it a success. We spend a lot of their tax dollars on other things. We see the results of their tax dollars, so we want to see the results of this project. Mr. City Manager, we look to you.
Okay. We got a few more minutes, Ms. Adams.
Yes. We do well when we work together. We're at our best when we work together, when we find solutions and things for the community. I have no doubt in my mind, I've talked with Mr. Brooks, I've talked with Mr. Garrity, that we can make this work. We will probably have to call on some of our community partners who love us so much that they come and visit us on a regular basis to make withdrawals from our bank. We're going to need some partnerships to make this work, because this is about the safety, the health of a community. It goes back to what Councilmember Taylor said, Montgomery, Ms. Burke and I. We got to work on the whole community as a family and a critical mass. And the only way we can do that is we have to get very innovative with other parts of our community and show our commitment to make this a better city to live in and to work and play, as Councilmember Taylor say. So I'm challenging the mayor, the city manager, Mr. Page, Mr. Brooks, Mr. Weston, Ujima, to go work together, sit down in a room two or three times, put the project together, go get some financing from somebody. We got partners, and you're going to have to use your influence to help make this happen, because it's a win-win for the city of Winston-Salem and the residents that live on the east side of 52 in downtown.
Do want to finish on time, and this is just for information. Mr. Montgomery has asked to go last, and I will give him that privilege, but I do have a few comments. First off, I think it would be helpful to have a map so we know exactly where this is. Number two, I would like to see the pro forma statement on how this is going to, you know, rent, expenses, that type of stuff, how all the numbers flow. Number three, I do share the concern that we're partnering with someone who's never done this. So I would like to know what resources the city can bring to bear. And we've had other instances where it did not work because we did not have some expertise. And I'm thinking more construction expertise and bidding and things of that sort. Lastly, and I will challenge Mr. Montgomery on this, we always seem to play so hard on workforce housing. And what we're saying here is, what is it? It's almost $800 a month for a one bedroom. I'm not sure who we doing a favor there to. I would like to see some information on market rates. And that's just two units. 26 of the one bedrooms are going for $900 a month. I'm not familiar with Trinity Glen, but if they are a comparable type thing. But I'm just concerned that because this thing is so highly leveraged, the rents may be up there. And I will say I have not rented an apartment in the city in 35 years or whatever. I lived in the same house forever. But anyway, but I would be interested in what the market rates are for comparable housing in the, you know, certain radius of it. Mr. Jones, I see you've stepped up. If you give your name and address,
I couldn't take it anymore because, first of all, y'all talking about something I don't think you're familiar with.
Give your name and address for record.
Hobart Jones, 4645 Palace Avenue, Winston-Salem, NC, 27101.
Okay. Before you go, Mr. Jones, I told your wife today that she didn't have to come with you. So
I know. And what I'm simply saying is New Bridge is $3 million. I think he said $300,000. It's $3 million.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks. And then it's $2.5 million. But what I can do tomorrow morning is bring my builder. We got a team. I can bring the bank in here. I'll let you look at the pro forma numbers. I'll let you look over the numbers. If you find something wrong with them, the bank is requiring us to have a 1.2. We're 1.3. We're very conservative in our numbers when you see pro forma, because we got a lot of media in there. So meaning, because we knew we had to do it conservative, because we wouldn't be able to go down any. But we got numbers that operate, and they'll stand the test of time.
Okay.
I have a church that told me if we have a problem, they're going to back us. That church paid out their mortgage in 12 and a half years. So I'm thinking that somewhere along the line, we just had every funeral in this weekend at the church. So we are a community organization, and we believe in what we do. We're already progressing in the neighborhood and doing weatherization. So what I'm saying, we got the rooker job we finna do for the city. And what I'm simply saying is we are workers and doers. Retired law enforcement officer, I know about dollars and cents. Vietnam disabled veteran. We also make contracts with different people and stuff. So what I'm simply saying is we are community people doing community things. We moved in with the SGX, and that's been the greatest thing happened because they take care of it in terms of guiding us and direct us in the proper place. I simply think they need to call a time and a place so we can bring our numbers, our paperwork, so we can move forward. We don't need to wait because we got to get this thing done and start working on it before the winter comes. Okay. July 1st, we want to be breaking ground.
Okay. Understand, we weren't given any of that information. That's why we're asking for it.
I sit back there and bit my lip, and I said, no, I can't hurt myself.
Okay.
I got to spill it.
All right. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Jones.
You. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? This is information only. Yes, and I will now, if there aren't any more, I will now let Mr. Montgomery get the last word, maybe.
Well, it was just in terms of culminating everything. Mr. Jones, the rest of the team, Emmanuel, and others, this has been a project that has been going on for years. It was a project when I came on council that had already been in its conception, has been processed. It's been something that staff has been working on for years as well. The individuals have come back and forth to City Hall time and time again, bringing more documentation, getting the letters of information from the banks, working with them to be able to provide the information. The CDC, Ms. Davis is here from SG Atkins CDC, who has also been advising and working with them, someone which we as a city has a very, very great proven track record with as well, who has supported this project as well. And then when we look at the community in which this is going to be sat in, we have to understand beyond, and this is what I want this council to look at, is that look at this project not just as a housing project, but look at it also in terms of the opportunity for residual impact on the neighborhood in which it's going to be located on.
Yeah.
Because when you place this in the location that it's going to be placed in, we have the opportunity to impact the properties in and without, in and around the area in which this will be placed. And so when we look at the dollars being invested in, I think we're going to get larger than just the impact of providing quality housing for retirees in a part of the community where that doesn't exist today,
right,
but also the opportunity of investment in single-family homes and properties in and around the community, doing exactly what we want to do, and that is revitalizing portions of our community that stand in need of that. And so when we look at it from that broader picture, I think looking at some of the unconventional ways in which we're looking at the financing makes sense when we look at that bigger picture of what we're doing. Now, we were saying this is just a straight, you know, financing of market rate in another part of community. I may have some of the same type of questions, but when we look at it from that perspective, I think it provides for us a greater opportunity to have larger impact in community. And I would take anybody who wants to, who hadn't been there, we can get in my car, we can drive there, and I can show you the property, we can show you all those things, and I think you'll walk away saying that it's a great opportunity to make a difference in that neighborhood as well.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Brooks, I think you've heard a number of comments. You'll put all that together, and this will come back next month, I believe.
Thank you.
Folks, we have one more item. I didn't realize that, so I got 10 minutes to do it. This is informational only also. This is a, trying to think who sent me this. Mr. Driver. You got 8 minutes. Do whatever you like.
Okay. Keep it short and sweet. Okay. There's an interest in converting, or let me back up. Good evening, Chairman Clark, Mayor, and members of the City Council.
Good evening.
There's an interest in converting four city-owned lots on 2nd Street across from Shady Boulevard into a passive city park property. The property is currently undeveloped, and there are existing restrictions on the property that would prohibit development. There's an existing 30-foot private drainage easement that runs along the northern and eastern property, and there's a 20-foot public utility easement that runs through the middle of the property. The property does have some outstanding debt associated with it. In your memo, there's a list of the transaction summary of the credits and debits that are associated with that property. But the total outstanding debt is approximately $285,000. The city's real estate division assessed the market value of the property and provided an estimate of value of $100,000, which the current debt on the property exceeds the market value. It's a recommendation to the City Council to consider designating $100,000 that were bond funds earmarked for parkland acquisition towards the balance of the debt, and then the remaining debt of $184,472 would be forgiven. At that point, we could develop it as a passive park.
Define passive park?
Mostly green space, benches, sidewalks, but
okay.
No active activities.
No swing set.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
No fields. And then if the council approves of this, then we will bring an item, a resolution, in April.
Okay. Mr. McIntosh, this is your ward, I believe.
It is. I just want to call everybody's attention. This is the area that we just passed the rezoning, and this is on the edge of it, where we went from limited office back to residential to reflect the fact that this is now a residential neighborhood, has been really, but it's now, we're recognizing that it is as high as the best use is for residential. The property just to the top side of the yellow rectangle just suffered a major sinkhole
yes.
incident. The spaghetti of concrete underneath this piece of dirt is amazing. Bill Benton had put this under contract, and he had figured out a way to squeeze some houses in there, but I swear it's a really difficult site to develop. The blend of housing that's around there now is widely varied in terms of demographics and income levels, and I think the feeling amongst the neighborhood is to have a passive park there would benefit not just the residents of the surrounding area, but downtown as a whole. Around this, within a couple block radius of this site, the population count is quite high, so this will benefit quite a few residents in the area, and also we're mowing it now and have been mowing it for years to bring in some pro bono landscape architecture work and to pretty it up. I think will just be a benefit to everybody involved.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Light.
Another thing about this piece of property that I am thankful that it is the idea of building three or four houses, whatever Bill was going to do, has gone away, is because, in fact, this was the original spring along the back of this property was the original spring that fed Old Salem in the 1700s. So, and there are even remnants, well, I don't know if there are remnants of the wooden pipes, but
the George Washington came.
So it really
George
does
Washington
need,
drank from this.
Pardon?
It's the right. fountain of youth.
Yeah. Okay, keep going.
No, so yeah, I think protecting it by letting it remain a green space is a great idea.
Yeah. I questioned when Mr. Benton, he came two or three times with different ideas. This is low land. It's almost a swamp, and maybe that's because the spring's there, but I just can't imagine anyone wanting to build a house on any of this. So I think it's a wonderful idea. Do we happen to own the lot across the street, across Second Street?
We do own...
That one is buildable. I think that one should be aggressively marketed. That, I think, would be a good place for a house. Okay. That's just for information only. I don't hear any comments. Let's move that forward. Anything else coming forward with committee? It is 5 till 6 at 6 o'clock at the appointed time.
Well done, Mr. Chairman. 6 o'clock.
The Public Safety Committee will convene. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. I would have bet against you.
Me too, right?